Hi, I'm Van Tazzi. I want to talk to you about some of the hand positions again from the Bubishi. Now you notice there's six hands in specific, and two are very confusing for people. One is the single blade of grass hand, and then you have the iron claw. Now people think that you can stick this in certain targets and you're going to cause a Dimmock effect, like you're going to kill the guy within 3 hours or whatever it says in the Bubishi. And that's not the way that operates. I mean, in the past, when they dug their hands into sand and rocks and beans and however they trained it until that thing was just a fused solid bone, it's possible to do it then. You got like more of a dagger for the cost of disfigurement. Back when you needed to protect yourself a little bit more with your hands, then that was a critical aspect. Today we don't need that. And I believe, like I mentioned in other films, that it morphed from this position into the Shokin, the Phoenix Eye Fist, whatever you call this hand position, to get a stronger attack without having to condition that finger for a long period of time. But I've also mentioned that this hand position is excellent for grabbing. All right. Now, when we're grabbing, if you use the iron claw for the grab, okay, and let's get into the specifics of that before we get into the comparisons. You have the iron claw. Okay, now the iron claw in the depiction looks like the fingers are pulled back, so the tendons on the back of the hand are doing the work as opposed to the fingers or the muscle strength or the compression of the hand. It's actually a withdrawal of the hand where you're using the back tendons of the hand here. Okay, you're also using the wrist and going into the muscle of the forearm, so you have a lot more muscle mass behind the action rather than just the simple little muscles that are on the inside. All right, and yes, you can pull afterwards, but if you've done this maneuver here where you've already activated this, you could also draw with it as well. Now let's go into a nerve right under the bone. Okay, if you try to squeeze in hard, you're not going to activate that nerve, because what happens is you've got a lot of tendon, muscle, you've got skin in the way. So what you need to do is you need to push in and then pull back. Okay, and that pulling action, that withdrawal action, that sinking action, that's what's going to cause the arm to get that target better. Okay, now when you're utilizing this, you don't utilize all the fingers, okay? But even if you've got a good grip and these are your primary fingers for the pain compliance or the dysfunction, you're going to notice that you don't have much flexibility in the way of turning the wrist. That's about the full range of my wrist turning action, okay? Now, if I've locked in with just these fingers as example, okay? Now, and this doesn't really apply to the wrist, but it can, and you do sort of this action in Aikido moves and a lot of different locks, okay, whether it be on the inside of the wrist, the outside of the wrist, very popular use in Aikido. When you're grabbing with this hand, look at the range of motion. It's a heck of a lot bigger. So if you're grabbing and twisting to tear, like on an artery, not so much a nerve, you can utilize the iron claw, because that iron claw really has a lot more power for this kind of contraction. The single blade of grass has more of a rotation this way. So this is more of a tearing action, where this would be more of a compression action. So you've got to look at these two hand positions and their limitations. You have to look at their positive effects, their power zones, and then you have to work with it. So I equate this more to a blood attack hand, okay? And I use this more as a nerve attack hand, just because of the sheer strength compared to this. Also for the retraction and the compression capacity rather than the tearing or twisting capacity. So when you compare the hands, you look at the different hands and they sort of think you see a similar type of an action performed with it. There's two different dynamics. And this is the kind of detail that you want to get into when you're doing the Kyusho, because Kyusho is the details, all right? You're refining. It's that mindset we were talking about on an earlier video. That constant refinement, you're looking at these tools and you're not just looking at, okay, what can I do with the tool, but how it's functioning. And that way you can maximize the effects that you're getting from it. Just knowing that this works better on blood and this works better on nerve, that's a huge detail. All right, now you can go out and you can work and you can be accessing the person's body. If, for example, you're on a person's upper arm, okay, and you're grabbing and utilizing your thumb, you're going to want to twist into that to get a little bit more penetration, to get deeper into the blood structures. Or if you're just utilizing the nerves, you can just grab in and twist and pull that nerve into the bone, okay, or separate the muscles to get into that tissue. So again, look at the details on everything you do, positive and negative. That's the yin and the yang, that's the bubishi, that's the white crane and the black tiger. Thanks for watching.